Initial references or something. And I think your system is also single line. Is it double?
Well.
No, single line, you know, the author. Yeah, so similar.
But actually, I get so big. Generally, you know, I'm. I know, it's crazy, it's like, I always say like that.
I love your songs. You're really sharing what you said.
Can you hear me on the audio?
Yes, we can hear you. Thanks, Phil.
Okay. All right.
Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. Right. what's the others? What is the rationale for? Why is that so? What is the rationale?
No, there are problems. So we actually have to say, right, how about going there?
So are you going to disrupt that?
No, I'm not talking about what's interesting about this is in the case of the government's thing. Whereas
how about patenting CRISPR when the government
I'm really interested in this play because we get here one day, and I'm going to have to go back to the
I think we had better get started with our next talk so that we can be sure to have enough time for discussion at the end of the meeting. So I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Phil Bourne, who will elaborate a little more about the potentials for scholarly communication in the future. So thank you for joining us, Phil.
Okay, thank you, Jessica, and thanks to you and to Ron for inviting me to say something here. Actually, I've been on since the beginning. It's been a very interesting discussion. I guess I'm actually representing in a position that I wasn't in before. First of all, I'm sorry I'm not there. I'm actually in the middle of cataract surgery. So if you could notice, I've only got one lens in my glasses. I apologize for that. It makes me less credible than usual, which I didn't. But in any case, what I'd like to say is sort of a little looking, I guess, a fair bit into the future and of what the possibilities are. I think we've heard a lot about, I think, very legitimate concerns concerning things like mission creep and the CC BY licensing issue and so on. But I'm actually coming at this not from my former role at NIH. As Patty Brennan just said, she's now the acting director, associate director of data science, which I was up until beginning of January. So certainly I was involved with Neil and many others in sort of NIH's position on this. But I'm now speaking to you actually as someone who is trying to use content. And this is where I'm trying to give you that perspective. So obviously I'm a keen supporter of preprints and ASAP Bio. As this is a meeting of societies, I should say that I was at one point a president of the International Society of Computational Biology, at which point with Russ Altman, who I succeeded, we joined FASIB. And so I do really appreciate all of this, looking at it from a society perspective. My area of research is computational biology, so I'm absolutely a data parasite in the New England Journal of Medicine sense. And I think where I'm really speaking from is my interest in scholarly communication, which comes from, as Cynthia knows, as prior with Helen Berman, involved in the RCSB Protein Data Bank, co-founding PLOS Computation and Biology, which was done not because in any way initially I was an open access advocate. In fact, it was just really about having a good representation of our science in the field. It was only after I started doing this that I started to see the values of open access, which then drove me into becoming a researcher in scholarly communication. And I just would sort of put in perspective for all the difficulties and issues surrounding what's possible. I must say that in my own efforts at attempting to use PubMed Central as a tool, particularly obviously in various types of machine learning activities, it's been very difficult. And I think Jessica showed an example this morning earlier on of what is beginning to be possible. But there are such enormous constraints on that corpus. And I think if we were doing this starting again, I don't think we would do things in quite the same way. Obviously, there's a lot of history associated with what's in PMC and the way things are licensed and the format of the content. But it makes it very difficult from the perspective of someone like me as a using scientist to make effective use of it. So with that backdrop, let me just sort of describe the current landscape. Some of this probably is going to be somewhat controversial. But it's just, I think, for the point of view of someone trying to use content, and I would hope that there would be significant representation of these folks in the governance and everything moving forward. Excuse me. So I think it's from my point of view, it is fair to say that that scholarly communication is largely for-profit business. While there's a lot of input into the scholarship itself, how and the controlling of that scholarship, the content, the form of how that scholarship is presented, I don't think necessarily scientists particularly understand or want to understand or and don't necessarily have a lot of input into. You can, of course, argue with that. There's always a cost associated with this, and open access, as we know, is an issue. And I think it's been brought up a couple of times this morning. One of the wonderful things that the current landscape does provide is sustainability, and that's going to be clearly a critical aspect for whatever happens moving forward with preprints. And of course, the access is controlled. But I think the bottom line, which is the last bullet, is that it's really what we have currently is an analog system functioning in a digital world. It wasn't actually, if it had been born digital, I think it would have been something quite different. And, that's just obviously history. And now we're trying to retrofit. But I think the excitement for me is that that what's happening and potentially could happen with preprints is really an opportunity to reinvent. And so preprints are really just a step, my perspective, in the evolution of scholarship and this ability to really have a fresh start if we were to look at it that way. I appreciate that most people wouldn't look at it that way, but from my point of view as a user of this content, it's how I view it. So I've just, in effect, told you the why. Let me consider the what and the how. But I think it's important to sort of figure out, so what is the end game? If we were to create and overcome all these barriers surrounding licensing and so forth, and uniform content and standardization, what would be the end game? I mean, what would we want to see in 10 years? What would be possible that really is not possible today? So I'm going to show you a hypothetical example. And you can see that this is probably going to not only did I start talking about this in 2005, but I think it's probably going to be my epitaph as well. But without seeing it realized, but I think it's certainly something that I dream about and try and move towards in whatever way I can. So let me just walk you through this sort of hypothetical example. That if we had unbridled content in a central place, standardized, and everything I've been saying, this would indeed be possible. And it would be what we haven't really discussed is the framework in which this would exist. If that was completely open, that it would encourage the community at large to innovate, and I'll come back to that. So one of these possible innovations could be this hypothetical example. So this happens to be one of my own papers, and some of you in the room, Cynthia in particular, probably gel with this, given that it's a protein kinase, but it's a study of actually the protein kinase superfamily. But in any case, the point is, in the top left-hand corner, you have what is a traditional paper. And what we've achieved is to move that into a digital form that looks and operates exactly the same. And that has huge value, obviously. And but I think you could argue strongly that it is only the one form of representation of that content. It's the one that we're most familiar with. It's the one we like, but there could be others. Then when you start digging into that, you know, right now you can go to a figure in that paper and you can click on that figure, which is in the bottom left. Now that figure then has an enormous amount of knowledge embedded into it that was provided by the authors of that work. The problem is it's just one representation. What you really want to do, of course, is to be able to further analyze that directly from the paper. So this takes us to the notion of an executable paper, which many of us have talked about for quite some time. I mean, where we are today is in some instances, in some journals, in some publishers, but not all, that's part of the issue. Is you could actually click on that image, and that would then take you directly to the protein data bank, where you could actually render that a representation of that data. However, it would look nothing like that figure. So all of the metadata, and that figure was produced by a machine, but we've lost all of that knowledge in that image because the metadata associated with that image is not available. If it were available, and this we haven't actually discussed where the preprint service could go down the line with the so-called data integration and analytics and many other things. But this is, you know, potentially possible. And then you you have this renderable image, and this happens to be something we actually created, actually for the protein data bank. But that also, what we haven't done is that you can also annotate that figure. So you can actually have annotations, and there are tools like Hypothesis for doing all of this. So this is not, as Ron has said before, this is sort of a 5% technology issue and a 95% cultural and social issue. You could either publicly or privately annotate that result. And then the idea, of course, is that result itself, that image that's here, actually becomes a queryable entity across the content of, in this case, we're talking about this this corpus of preprints. So you could, for example, query a particular element that's tagged appropriately, and there's a characteristic of these molecules called the glycine-rich loop. So you could click on that. That is tagged. That would then bring up tags associated with the whole corpus, which could be data as well of the publications. That then gives you, in the top right-hand corner, a mashup of a whole series of information about the image itself, but also taking you to the next line of inquiry. So that then, which then, of course, could be another paper. So it could be a preprint presented in a paper-like format, or it could be presented in some other kind of format, such as a knowledge graph that interrelates all the references to glycine-rich loops together. So these are the excitement for me is the prospect of this actually being able to happen. And I think the a central preprint service and the constraints we've been talking about could actually potentially do that. But you know, why is this, why is it important? Well, I've given you one sort of example, at least in my own personal point of view. But it's, I think this represents a big opportunity because frankly, it publishes, and it's sort of starting to happen, of course, and it's being driven by competition in the marketplace. But if publishers were going to do it, they could have done it already because it's there aren't the technical impediments to doing it. And of course, the preprint service provides this unfettered content, and that content is owned and governed by the community in the way that we've been talking about, at least if it's in accordance with CC BY. And then, of course, it also provides a playground from which the sort of unimaginable can happen. I mean, I think I'm very limited in my visioning of what could happen with that content. So what do we need to get there? And I'll give you another example of that visioning in a minute. I think appropriate governance, which I think ASAP Bio really brings to the table with the all the appropriate stakeholders there. I'll say a little more about incentives in a second, some of which you've covered. Obviously, accessibility we've also covered. Ease of use, we haven't really spoken about too much, but clearly that has to be really front and foremost if something like this preprint service was to work. It has to be sustainable. I'll say a bit more about that. And then I think it needs to be open and collaborative because there's so much opportunity in what could be done that it's way more than one group can accomplish. I think the idea that it's a crowdsourced model where people are contributing and it becomes essentially a platform, which by the way, is where many industries are going in any case, whether it be open or closed, that's a different matter. But certainly this notion of having a platform on which to operate from in a particular way. So how do we get there? I think we obviously ASAP bio governance, I think, is very important to this. And I won't go over these things except to say that because they've already been covered very well by Neil and funders and so forth. But I think for publishers and others and societies, it does represent new business models for added value services. And I think this could be a really powerful new development that not only do the is it contributed to by scientists in the public domain, but also for, by publishers and societies for the benefit of those organizations. And it will freestand in the marketplace. And of course, we all gain in the end with the potential for visualization, or better comprehension through visualization, aggregation, and distillation. Of course, the accessibility we've talked about and the hurdles to that and the issues with that have been well spoken about. So I'll just emphasize the points that actually Jessica made particularly, but the need for the appropriately tagged and consistent content. I mean, I think that that is that sort. If you look at PubMed Central as an example that uses JATS, which is an XML extension to describe that content, it works moderately well, but I think there are issues there. So, for example, in trying to use that content, it's actually been cleaned up some, but initially, and it's still true, that you couldn't even determine what the licensing was because the licensing tag in PubMed Central either wasn't present or wasn't used consistently. So I think there's a lot we can learn from the corpi that we already have about how to do this better in, if we were to, as we move forward with a central preprint service, obviously machine readable. And then it was just to emphasize that, and this relates to ease of use, there needs to be, this is really the melding of real technical expertise with content expertise to create the appropriate APIs to provide the simplest and fullest access to that content. So the sustainability, I think, over time, it comes from a value proposition for funders in the sense that having this, if content gets out there quicker and is more usable, that advances the science. And ultimately, that's what funders are really trying to achieve and are more likely to put effort into sustaining such an initiative. So it could be, it could grow iteratively. I think there's, advantages to publishers potentially, that if on this platform, open source tools and other things are developed to leverage that content, then there's absolutely no reason why publishers and anyone else for that matter can't actually use them, enhance them, create new business models from them. And so it actually, there's a sort of feedback loop that has some value to publishers, one could argue. And of course, by being open and collaborative, it's that knowledge becomes a community responsibility. And that I think is where the governance and other aspects. And of course, the innovation can come from anywhere. But I think the there's some cautions with this, as I'm sure you're all thinking. But here's another hypothetical scenario that I think could actually be achieved in pretty short order. I think we have to recognize that the speed of developments in various aspects of machine learning are really going to because I'm involved in this. But are really going to impact how we use knowledge, whether it be from the scientific literature or elsewhere, in ways that we have only just beginning to see. And I think there are early evidence of some of these of some of this, and we could talk about that. That's really not on topic. So one hypothetical case is you've submitted a significant number of preprints to the preprint service. So there is software that analyzes your submissions and builds a profile. Now, we know this happens to some degree already. For any one of you who use ResearchGate, we know how well that doesn't work at the moment. But this is clearly going to get much better. So by the existing body of work you've produced, you get an ever-increasing accurate profile. Then that profile is matched against each incoming submission to the preprint service, which are then periodically rank ordered and reports come to you. So it's a push mechanism. So you're getting a knowledge push at how frequently you might want it that really describes things that are most pertinent to you. There's lots of arguments against that related to serendipitous findings, for example. But, you know, over time, all these kinds of things can be built into a system. So but it would potentially have a big plus. So it's really, I've called the PubMed-related article feature, which comes about by really rigorous and consistent indexing, is this could be essentially that on steroids. Well, this could be a PubMed-related article, which I think most people would agree is useful, but you could really enhance that. Because it can be done because it's not relying on a small number of developers. It's relying on the work of a large community of developers. In fact, anyone who wants to develop on that corpus. So I think for me, this is the kind of promise. So to sum up, I would say that an appropriate preprint service is a framework for innovation. And that to me is an enormously exciting aspect of it all. But at the same time, I think that has a positive and negative aspect. So, you know, if you think about, I think because we can't in any way anticipate what would actually come out of such a framework. And the World Wide Web to me is another example of that, where I don't think when Tim Berners-Lee, and I've actually talked to him about this, I don't think that there was any perceived understanding of the impact that social networks would have as a result of the World Wide Web, or that, which you could argue was positive or negative. On the other hand, we've also started to see clear implications of fake news when everyone has a voice and an ear. So there's a lot of caution, but as well a lot of promise in providing a sort of framework for innovation. And so I would close just by saying it's the responsibility of the scientific community at large, this is my opinion, personal opinion, and the societies that represent those communities to make the most responsible use of innovations in scholarly communication, including preprints. So that's sort of a scientist perspective who's trying to use that content. So thanks a lot. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hang up for questions.
I thought I might have been talking into the vapor for the last few minutes.
No, not at all. Does anyone have questions or comments for Phil?
I'll be happy to comment. This is Maria. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I can hear you, Maria.
Hi, Phil. Of course, as you know, we here at EMBO couldn't agree more with you on the way the literature should be exploited and used and enhanced. And as many of you know, we've been developing one tool that does something that others don't do, and that is extracting the metadata out of, or you know, supplementing, annotating figures with metadata. So totally with you, and that is clearly one part of the ideal scenario that I'd fully subscribe to. What I'm wondering is whether, and we are now doing it not on preprints, but on journal papers. And we've got a pilot project, and anybody who wants to look at smart figures to do that. In the end, will it not have to be done on the published papers? Because not the ideal is, of course, everybody will put out preprints, but that is unlikely to be the reality. Also, not everybody is going to, not everything that starts out as a preprint is going to end up as the final literature in that form. I know we'll have versioning. I know they'll be tagged. They'll be connected. But the question is whether the most valuable place to do this is the preprints or is in the journals where the papers, the definitive data will eventually get published. That is one point I was going to make. What's the other one? Well, let's leave it at that one for the moment.
Let me respond to that then. So
if we insist on, I think it's wonderful to use preprints for it, but if it's restricted to preprints, then we're going to be excluding a lot of stuff.
Right. I mean, so let me respond to that in the sense that just by you said we are doing this, you know, but the we is one segment of the obviously it's fantastic you're doing this, but the promise here is that, you know, it's not done in a set of separate silos, that it's done in a very open way in which the community contributes. You build on one system, and what actually gets rolled into the system is a function of what bubbles to the top as being the best innovation. So it's really a community driven rather than a series of individual efforts. That's not to say that whatever comes out of that shouldn't be applied to the formal peer-reviewed literature, or vice versa for that matter. So, you know, if some innovation in the subset of the content that's handled by one publisher, if that innovation can either be replicated or given to the preprint service. So it seems to me that this is the relationship in this regard with respect to preprints and preprint central service and other forms of publishers and publishing places is synergistic, not you know, in the best possible, it could be synergistic in the best possible scenario.
It definitely should, and that it wasn't. I wasn't saying one should restrict anything. I agree with the community effort, and if I say we are doing this, then I see we this part of EMBO as part of the general community that will be applied to everything, journals, preprints, whatever makes sense. But what I'm saying is it's neither absolutely necessary to focus it on reprints, nor necessarily beneficial to focus it on reprints. I think all these things, these wonderful things that you were describing, should be applied to the literature everywhere. That's all I was saying.
I obviously agree with that. I would say, you know, I think it's also should be acknowledged in all of this that there is competition between the existing entities doing this, and sure. that's been a, you know, obviously a healthy thing, and competition at some level is good. I think what I think it's a question of where you put where the pre-competitive line is. So the idea that there's, you know, this sort of shared space and shared corpus that is operated on in pre-competitively, and then people can take the fruits of that and then actually create something that has additional value that creates ultimately sustainability, all seems to be a good thing.
Also to that point, I just want to add that very clearly articulated in the funder principles from these 11 major funding agencies, and also reflected in this request for application, you know, to build the central service, is the premise of open source software. So all of the software tools, whether they be document conversion APIs, are going to be available to the entire community. So that will hopefully spread, you know, lateral, you know, innovation of the type that Maria was describing.
If there are no other immediate comments right now, it may be good for us to shift to the panel so that we can hear from three representatives from societies who are innovating with preprints and publishing in general. And we can continue the discussion to Phil's point and these points afterwards, but Erica, our first panelist, will need to run relatively soon, so hence the need for accelerating the program. So Erica, if you wouldn't mind speaking to us first.
Sure, my pleasure. So I'm from the American Society for Cell Biology, and as you probably saw in the introduction, as Ron and Jessica introduced themselves, our society's had a lot of members that have been very active in this area for quite some time, and so have had a number of initiatives that really relate. And I think, you know, for ASCB, that society's been active not only in areas around reproducibility of research, also, of course, DORA, the Declaration on Research Assessment, and have general interest in openness in science. And I think all of this feeds in to an interest in supporting preprints and figuring out a way to work with them in our publishing matrix. So, you know, our interests are basically in making research findings accessible sooner and providing the opportunity for dialogue within our members. You know, whether it occurs at our society meeting or if it occurs online, we want our members to be able to have those conversations. And no problem. And you know, and a lot of our view is driven by this is sort of the next generation of what has been going on for generations in scientists. You know, there's obviously always been poster and conference presentations, and I think as was raised earlier, that of course has barriers. People have to physically get somewhere, they have to pay costs in order to attend a meeting, whereas preprints give the opportunity to have a dialogue that really lowers that barrier, that sort of really provides a democratization in science that is also of interest for our society. So I thought just briefly I'd talk about, you know, what are we doing just as sort of an exemplar. You know, I think it's still early days, but we do allow preprints to be cited in our reference sections, whether they're on bioarchive or on archive. You know, along with, we also allow citation of articles that are both published or in press as well, but also preprints. As I mentioned earlier, one of the things we are about to tweak is probably to require that those citations also require the version number in it, so that we are really capturing that moment that they are cited. We are do have a direct submission from bioarchive that went online last year, and we haven't gotten a huge number, but we have had about 9 submissions in the last 6 months that have come direct in from bioarchive. And you know, we're not only looking for the kind of opportunity for authors to send it to us, we do have editors as well that are out looking for opportunities and then being able to recruit in. So just as editors might prowl the quarters of a poster session or presentations at a meeting, they can also look through preprints and see ones that they think would make good stories and good submissions for our journals. So those are the number of the things that we're doing to sort of bring them in, and we're eager to sort of see where this is developing and the kind of next generation tools that will come about, and we'll be interested in looking further. But that's sort of in a nutshell what we're doing at this point in time.
Thank you very much, Erica. I'd now like to ask Stefano Bertuzzi to speak to us, and I will bring up your presentation in just one.
We can all huddle around you, Ron. Excellent. There we go. Oh, it's really small. So what I try to do, being from Microbiology Society, bring you 3 digital Petri dishes today. And the first one is how ASM is thinking in general about preprints. So first I'd like to remind you that the way we see our role in this field is that our mission is to promote and advance microbial sciences. And when I first saw it, I thought the statement was as provocative as saying that Venice is wet. However, the more I've been thinking about it, it is actually a very provocative statement, because what this means is that what the society needs to do is not to promote ASM, is not to promote its journal, is not to promote its meetings, is not to promote its whatever activities we do, but what we have at heart is making sure that we have scientific progress in microbial sciences. And I am deeply, deeply committed, you know, to this issue. So whatever, and what Phil was just talking about is a prime example, it takes to make microbiology successful, we're in, and we're here to advance and promote that. With this said, we're a large society. We have over 50,000 members in 122 countries, and we publish 17 journals. 12 are peer-reviewed primary data journals, and 4 are open access, so we have a stake in this. ASM from the get-go has been supporting of preprints and accepting preprints from bioarchive. And also, obviously, we support peer-reviewed edited publication. We think there is an enormous value in this. And our Our view is that we believe in a scholarly communication ecosystem where preprints and scholarly publication can coexist, enhance, and ultimately advance and promote microbial sciences. As I was mentioning before, we see preprints as interim research products with great value, and we would really like them to stay that way, you know, at interim research product, easy to use, and for the author to be very flexible on what they choose to use the from and what to do with them. We see preprints as not a substitute for publication, and as I have expressed before, I at ASM, we have concerns about adding too many requirements on preprints and moving away from this interim nature that we have discussed. So what have we done with this? So I'm going to present you two very brief, and one is just started last month, experiment that we're doing, and one we're launching in June. And so they're both very new, and we would have done neither of those if the discourse about preprints wouldn't have started. So that's a prime example of how you at ASAP Bio and the whole discussion about preprints is stimulating us to innovate. That's precisely what needs to happen. The question is, how can we do our job better with new tools and new way of doing it? So in January, we launched MSphere Direct, which is a new track for peer review for a journal. And you can't read this, and it's actually don't even need to read it. I'll tell you in very few words. Ultimately, what Jessica was saying before really resonates with me a lot. It's the idea that by putting a preprint out there, you can have a conversation and get feedback early on from a much larger community than your three postdoc fellows, you know, around you in the lab or other people that you may know. And this is very valuable. So what we thought at ASM is, well, if that is the case, what about experimenting in changing the relationship between authors and reviewers? So ultimately, we see the pesky reviewer number three, which comes back and whacks you on the head. But in reality, there is a possibility, and again, it's an experiment, of seeing the reviewers are giving you feedback early on while you're working on your paper, not in a dark room filled with smoke, but in a transparent way of how you can improve your paper and what you'd like to see. So that's what MSphere Direct does. It asks the author to identify reputable reviewers that can work with them and review their publication, and we ask them to submit all their reviews and their relationship with their reviewers, together with a statement that their reviewers are comfortable with the papers that is being submitted. We have very strict conflict of interest rules for what is considered a valid reviewer, which actually happen to be even stricter than for our journal. So you're happy to go on MSphere and check them out. And the goal here is that in 5 days, the editorial team of MSphere will make a decision whether the paper is accepted or not. At this point, this relationship has already occurred, so there's no time to wait, and the decision will be made. I want to be very clear that this we don't see this as a shortcut on peer review at all. Actually, we expect the quality of the papers published through MSphere Direct to be exactly the same as the other papers in MSphere, and we're very rigorous about that. What changes is the discourse and how you get there, and moving from the reviewer as being foe to being sort of a friend, someone who can give you feedback really early on in your work. So what does this have to do with preprints? As I said, first of all, we would not have thought it We would have not thought of it if it weren't of what Jessica referred to, this new thinking about the role of the early on feedback from a broader audiences. And second, part of our structure of MSphere Direct is that we strongly encourage, we don't mandate it, but we really, really like it. And we make it very clear for the authors to post their manuscript with their reviews, if they choose, as comments on BioArchive. And so what happens is that the editors in 5 days make the decision. So if the authors so choose, in 5 days, you actually have the final paper peer reviewed available. And we work to deal with BioArchive that they're actually going to immediately label it as accepted for publication in MSphere. So someone who trolls preprints will actually see that this paper has been reviewed. If the author chose, can see the reviews, and it will be published within a month in MSphere. Information, you have a URL there. Let me switch gear to another innovative project that we're trying, and this will launch in June, but we just released now a site where you can sign up for information if you want to. The website is micronow.org. You can go there and enter your email address, and we'll keep you updated. So MicroNow is a little bit different. So MicroNow, essentially with MicroNow, what we're doing, I always use this image, we're building a porch in front of ASM headquarters. So when you, a digital porch, DC code didn't allow us to do it physical. Essentially, when you come to our website or when you interact with ASM, it's obviously, so it's about ASM very often, you know, come to our meeting, publish in our journal, do this, do that. So what we're doing with MicroNow instead, it's an outreach in the middle of the street. So the focus is on the science and actually is building that digital communities around initially two different communities that we're building. One is the microbiome community, and the other one is the biothreat community. And so in this platform, what will happen is a platform run by scientists, for scientists. It's all about the science. And what it does, it will aggregate the information that's available throughout the world in the digital space that this faculty, and I'll get a little bit in a little detail on this, think it's important, you know, for the community to be seen. In essence, what's happening of all this wonderful things in the digital space of preprints, of blogs, information, data available, is that it becomes, the signal-to-noise ratio becomes an issue, and where do I find things? And so what MicroNow wants to do is aggregate that information in a way that is vetted, that is thoughtful, and that a group of representatives in the community think it's worth seeing. So this is what I just told you. And they're going to be online communities. Preprints are going to be a big part of this, and give you some data. So right now, and today, our incoming journals board chair, Pat Schloss, has posted an article on BioArchive. I encourage you to go see it because it's very, very interesting. There's a lot of good information in there. So an analysis done by December 31st, we found that there were 7,434 preprints. Of these, 329 were labeled as microbiology, were in the microbiology category. However, when we looked into it, there actually were 1,228 papers, preprints, that actually would fit in the definition of microbial sciences. And BioArchive doesn't allow to put them in multiple category, and so you could choose. And but feeding from three different categories, like evolutionary biology, genomics, and bioinformatics, we thought that actually they were very germane and we could consider them microbial sciences. 146 of these over 1,000 papers had comments, and 404 of these, of the total, 1,228, so about 25%, actually had revised versions of that, which to me goes in the direction of thinking that maybe there have been some feedback and some going back and forth that happened so that people felt, you know, that they have a revised version of it. Could be an indicator that actually what we're doing all this for is working. And if we look at all the preprints that were in BioArchive prior to January 1st, about 35% in the category, the broader category of microbial sciences, actually were published afterwards, and the other one apparently not after 1 year. So why am I giving you this number? It's because wading through all this can be complicated, and not everybody is going to do it. So what MicroNow will do is building APIs on top of BioArchive so that we can ingest what is relevant from the preprints community into what is relevant for the microbial sciences, which is what we're here for, to build the digital forum. We will also include journal articles, of course, news, policy briefs, and dialogue with experts in a very interactive way. So we also have, as I mentioned, a daily brief and everything that microbiologists need to know today. And it can be policy, it can be news from the New York Times, or anything else that can be relevant. So in essence, this is the vision for MicroNow. We have lots of sources, you know, whether it's published journals, preprints, it can be data, it can be blogs, and we are establishing a very distinguished Kavli dream team. We're sponsored by Kavli in this project, which it calls a faculty of ASM, starting with about 15 leaders in microbiology, and we'll have an associate faculty as well, which would be younger scientists like postdocs and graduate students, that will help curating the information that will go in MicroNow and starting conversation and discussion. So now you understand why I was talking about the digital forum for microbial sciences and why this is a porch in front of ASM. It's focusing on our community, on our topics, and whether you're a member of ASM or not is completely irrelevant here. But once you're there, you know, we may invite you to come into the house in the living room and figure out what else ASM can do for you to promote microbial sciences. So again, preprints are going to be essential for this because, and I, what Phil was saying really resonates with me, getting the information available, mobilized, jumping, and connecting the data that underlies figures. It's really what eventually this will get to. So again, if you want to get information of this, you can pull out your cell phone right now. And if you text at the number 38470, MicroNow space your email address, you will be on our mailing list and you will receive information about MicroNow. So 38470 and just type in MicroNow space and then your email address. So ASM is a digital forum and the authoritative aggregator of knowledge to promote and advance microbial sciences. To me, what we're trying to do is really thinking in this digital world where we have captured the digital age by converting fiber paper into digital paper, meaning PDFs, as Phil was saying, I see there is a bigger role now for society to aggregate that information, not just to produce the information with our own journals or meetings, but actually aggregate and serve the community to advance the sciences. So that's how we're thinking about it.
Thank you very much. And finally, we have Darla Henderson from ACS.
Actually, I'm going to skip slides. I will make those available for posting online in the interest of time. I wanted to report to you a little bit about our efforts with chemistry preprints. So some of you may have noticed late last year, we announced our plans to organize and to lead the organization of a chemistry preprint server. And you might say, why is the world's largest scientific society organizing? Why not just put a preprint server up there? The main reason is culture. And I'll talk a little bit about later on what I think societies can bring and offer to help with those cultural changes. Our culture basically had no real acceptance of preprints. There were some pieces of our culture that touched on physics that had long been familiar with this, but even those pieces would say, oh, 10% of the time I submit to archive. So it wasn't even thoroughly adopted in the physics community. In our biological community, they were starting to work with bioarchive. But with chemistry in a whole, there was, you know, an identified need for a real cultural shift. And so we made our announcement, and since that time have been very busy trying to develop that big tent, a collaborative effort with different societies. So one of the big first efforts that we undertook was community engagement. And I mean engaging with everyone. And you will have those editors and editorial board members and society members who say, I don't get this. I'm never going to submit a preprint. That's okay. This isn't for everyone right now, and we're not asking for it to be for everyone. And I think that's a real effective message, presenting this as a democratic choice that every user can make has really been enlightening. And then getting our editors around a table, which I did in January of this year, to talk about it and to let them hear that, wait, my colleague here goes to a preprint server and uses a preprint server, that's really powerful. That's more powerful than any sell that you can do as a society lead. So I would strongly encourage significant community engagement everywhere you go. That extends beyond your authors, your editors, your board members, to your divisions, if you have divisions, anyone who expresses an interest, funding agencies, preprint initiatives like ASAP Bio, other societies, kind of the whatever, whenever approach to real community engagement.
What we settled on, why we care about preprints, it's really about our mission as well. We're a mission-centered organization with the focus on advancing the broader chemistry enterprise and its practitioners for the benefit of Earth and its people. So that's a pretty big tent. And our first goal of our strategic plan is about being the most authoritative and indispensable provider of chemistry-related information. And preprints are a piece of that cycle that we have not embraced. We have meetings with posters and presentations. We have journal articles, letters, communications, reviews, books, databases. We kind of have a big picture circle, but preprints hasn't been embraced. And we really wanted to provide that opportunity for the sections of our community that want to do that. So a society has a wonderful role in bringing about cultural changes. Within your own community, the internal forces are there for and against the change, and they're going to remain there. They don't go away. But there are external forces and lessons learned, which we learned about earlier. Some of the 25-plus year history of archive can set at ease some of those concerns. I wanted to outline five key contributions that I see societies bringing to the table. The first is educating, informing, engaging. That piece of it is critical. It's not going to be very comfortable conversations in some situations, but starting the conversation is really important. Finding a way to mesh what preprints does with your own vision, if it meshes with your own vision, is really helpful. Innovating and experimenting, and then coordinating community-led governance and best practices. And that involves, as we all know, as society leads, openly acknowledging and starting to address challenges. We are still learning about the challenges to a preprint system from our community. We're still hearing that and engaging, and that will continue. We have a meeting this fall at our national meeting organized around preprints with the sole purpose of talking about the advantage, but also on the flip side, letting people bring forth those challenges and starting to find ways to resolve that. And the last piece is societies are very good at finding sustainable paths. We know how to find ways to make things work. We're nonprofit, and we can find a way to make that sustainable path more aggressively than traditional publishers can. I think the core of what societies bring to the preprint issue is trust, and that community relationship is really what we have to offer. I will end with just a brief update of where we are with ChemArchive. So that community engagement has happened over the past year. I have been to 40 of our 50 journal boards. We have transitioned our journals from not accepting preprints, pretty much with a very few exceptions, to 70%, and that conversation is going on with the remaining 30% in the next 6 months at their physical board meetings. So community engagement, partnership, we have also taken the approach of the big tent, so we have non-disclosures with various societies signed, and discussions are ongoing related to those partnerships. I can't announce anything here. We've drafted our product requirements. Those will continue, we think, to evolve, so we acknowledge that we're going to need change to whatever we launch in the first year, because we think our community may have specific needs. We're exploring our platform options. We sent out an RFI last December and have 6 bids in hand, kind of narrowing it down to the top 2 vendors. And we've thought about our governance, which is really important. If you're developing a big tent, not only your organization, it's the other organizations that you're trying to bring on board so that you really have a global cultural change in your chemistry community. That's what I have to share. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Darla and really all 3 of you for speaking to how societies can engage with preprints and the benefits that can have for scientists and societies as well. So I know that Erica does need to leave, but if there's any questions immediately for her or any of the panelists.
So I have a question for Darla. I'm very impressed that you went to 40 editorial board meetings. Congratulations.
So, Barbara, your salary is cut in half now.
We don't know what she makes. I'm always interested in kind of the demographics whenever there's a cultural shift like this. And I'm just wondering if in your conversations with all these editors, you're noticing that there's kind of a generational divide.
Yeah, it does seem that there's some of that, although not entirely. So one of our editors who is more established and older, absolutely ready to go with preprints. And I think that's because this person has more experience with biology, and so they're seeing what's happening in bioarchive. But in general, that's my overall impression, is that there definitely is a cultural shift. And we have folks coming up to us who are very young scientists at awards events and so on, saying, tell me when that's opening, because I want to post my preprint. And so that the excitement is much more, I would say, in the younger generation. And it's helpful that most of our editorial board meetings are at ACS national meetings or key events, so I'm just dashing around at those events.
I have one more comment just to add to Stefano's presentation. So we actually have, you know, one paper now that's gone through the MSphere Direct process. And we have a survey that comes up at the final decision stage just so that we get some feedback on how it went. And the comment that I really liked from this particular author was that he felt exactly as Stefano described. He was in control of the review process. It was more collegial. It was an exchange that was intended to improve the quality of the paper. It wasn't a confrontation. So I thought that's what we're aiming for. So I thought that was a, you know, very nice initial reaction to the process.
And I was remiss that I didn't mention Barbara in all this. Without Barbara's energy, MSphere Direct and MicroNow would not have happened. So all the credit goes actually to Barbara. But Baron, what Barbara just said now is, I think what you were saying, you know, put the joy of publishing, you said, into the system. That's what MSphere Direct wants to do.
Well, in a way, it's democratizing what National Academy of Science members have been doing for decades, you know, which is orchestrating review and then submitting, you know, high quality reviews as part of the publication pipeline. So it's not that it's never been tried also, but you're bringing that to a broader, you know, sphere of individuals. So
I guess this may be too big of a question to ask, but I'll ask it anyway. So if funders like NIH changed our rules, so products on these services you're setting up could count in a progress report or a bio sketch, what do you think that would do for these efforts you're doing? And for your membership? Because you, Darla, you were talking specifically about how this is a culture shift. And does the fact that a funder comes on board accelerate this culture in a good way, or does it create pressure to sort of overdo this because now people feel they have to, which we don't want to do. We don't want to create a mandate, even an implied one.
I would say it creates more awareness when a funder brings on board a mandate. But as you know, even mandates can be hard to implement. Some funders are looking at that. So I would say overall, definitely when a funder comes on board and says, we accept this as an interim report, it does accelerate the visibility of a preprint server and what the preprint server has to offer.
I would second what Darla said, and in our comments to your RFI was essentially that, you know, we're supportive of it. Just make it distinct what is a peer-reviewed publication from interim product, and then it will be the subject matter experts, the reviewers in the study section or elsewhere, that will make the decision of what to them is valuable or not. I don't think it's your decision. I don't think it's our decision to make that, but give them the option.
If I could, I just want to echo a few things that were just said in this discussion, also wearing the ASAP Bio hat, and how important culture is and where societies can play an enormous role. And, you know, that is, we all know the life sciences are not a monolithic entity. You know, they're built up of communities. We, again, looking at the lessons of archive, what has happened in archive is different communities got nucleated, embraced the idea. There was kind of, you know, a whole bunch of nucleating kind of peer group cultures that contributed to archive. It wasn't physics as a monolithic entity or computer sciences as a monolithic entity. So, you know, what we are trying to do with this central service or ASAP Bio is kind of think of across disciplines, because that's what we have to do. And like if we self-analyze our weaknesses, it's that we don't have the reach into particular communities in the biological sciences where those kinds of cultures are going to take hold. And you know, in that regard, like this partnership with scientific societies is just essential, because you are community builders, and if culture change is going to happen at a broader level, it's going to be built up community by community. And I also just want to emphasize the element of education and information. I think we went into this first meeting in February, honestly, having no idea what the outcome was going to be. We wanted to do the experiment well of having a good discussion, but in reality, we hadn't planned beyond February 17th because, you know, we didn't know what the outcome of the experiment was going to be. But what was very interesting is a lot of people came into that room from very different backgrounds, very different initial opinions. So it was not a uniform audience to begin with. As you said, when you walk into a journal editorial room, you're not coming into a group that necessarily has uniform opinion. But what was, I think, encouraging and interesting is just through, you know, getting the correct information on the table, having a good discussion, bringing up issues that, you know, sometimes are obvious, sometimes difficult and requiring debate. Just by doing that, where that group started that meeting on February 16th and where it left on February 17th were completely different. And the only difference was exactly what you said, education and information. And, you know, to bring that at a, you know, to some extent, it's going to be helpful that happens board meeting to board meeting, you know, council meeting to council meeting, but also having discussions at your scientific meetings or engaging in conversations through other things that you do with your individual communities. That's the kind of conversations, obviously, that we cannot do with ASAP Bio alone, and where, you know, societies know their communities, they can have those discussions, and where, you know, we're kind of eager for this partnership, because it's quite obvious that that's just impossible, you know, even thinking about scale for us, you know, to do by ourselves. But again, the encouraging thing is when people hear the right information, they have a chance to talk about it. The hopefulness of the situation is that people come around. When scientists try their first preprint, they find out that the sky has not fallen down, you know, that there are actually good outcomes and that they're more eager to do it again. So, you know, the hopeful situation is cultural change, especially as something that has so many interlocking elements and such a large scale, seems overwhelmingly daunting that in many cases we just don't try things. And I think the hopefulness here is that, you know, changing culture is not impossible, that we shouldn't be afraid to tackle it. In fact, we have a responsibility to tackle it almost for, I would say, the benefit of the public and the next generation of scientists. And, you know, the fact that scientific societies all around here are willing to engage in that enterprise would, you know, I think is part of the hopeful message that we all would like to create, that, you know, we can advance scientific culture as well as pure scientific information.
I
Just to add on to that, I'd like to ask a question, which is, I think this just short meeting so far has been really valuable to hear your perspectives, not only from our panelists, but from everyone around the room. And my question would be, going forward, what else can we do in order to keep this dialogue going? And how can we partner with you in order to have more of these conversations?
Help to this awkward pause, but but also we would like to take out of this meeting, in addition to those ideas, like also issues that you would like more discussion on, and you know that you think do require, you know, more clarity, debate, etc. I mean, not that though, you know, I think the idea is that many of these issues are also going to be conversations that happen not over weeks, but over months and years, and we need to create a mechanism for having those conversations. But, you know, we would be very happy leaving this room also to hear from you, not only how we can engage you, but also the kind of conversations that you want to hear going forward, or, you know, I mean, we've already heard about licensing, I think, as one key thing. Governance. But, you know, there are other issues, too, that I think we'd welcome that opportunity to hear them now.
I have a question, which is, why not work with BioArchive, for example, which is a nonprofit, it's going to be grant supported, to strengthen that platform rather than start something from scratch?
I can begin. So BioArchive has made amazing contributions to preprints in the life sciences, and we're, you know, really enthusiastic about what they are doing and have been doing. And we want to emphasize that this RFI or RFA, excuse me, is open, and any entities can respond to it. And certainly that includes existing entities who are in the space. I think the recognition of BioArchive is really important, and I think that is a really valuable asset for preprints in the life sciences. The reason that certainly this could strengthen an existing preprint server or a consortium of entities, but we see that the distribution of preprints in different areas, including the fact that I think there have been preprints on archive for, you know, a decade in the QBio section, and there will be in Chem Archive as well. There will be discipline crossover. And I think that in itself is one reason, which is independent of some of the other things we talked about.
If I could jump in there. So, I mean, as Jessica said, BioArchive can respond to this RFA and to become both both where one deposits preprints directly, as well as indexing and collecting preprints from other preprint servers. One analogy I'd like to make, it's about 17 years ago, the protein data bank, there was a call for proposals. That it was a competitive renewal. And the protein data bank had, at that point, this was in the late 90s, had become intimately associated with Brookhaven. I mean, the format was our programs. We called it the Brookhaven format for the PDB. They opened it up, and Rutgers, the consortium of Rutgers and UCSD, won the grant and took it away from Brookhaven. And I cannot, you can't possibly imagine the hue and cry in the community of why was the PDB moving? Why was there a hostile takeover, which is how it was depicted? And yet what had happened is an outside group came in and said, here are our ideas for how the PDB can be so much more than what it is today. And they really had a vision that the current members, It was run very well, but there was another group that had a vision for what it could be. So I think of this RFA in that way. The BioArchive has been great, and maybe they'll come through with the best proposal, but maybe another group will have a vision for something even better that will serve the community that much better. And this gives a group the opportunity to look at all those proposals and choose the best.
I'd like to go back to Jessica's question. So how can we help, essentially, or how can we engage? Well, I have two suggestions. Sound like from the conversation we had earlier this morning, seems like the issue of governance and what preprints should include and not include is a sensitive topic with this group. So I'm speaking for myself now, perhaps for Barbara, is that we'd like to be engaged in that conversation. And you heard concerns from us, and so echo what Maria was saying before, right? So a few people heard it, but not the community at large. So that's whatever form you will take, would be happy, you know, to have that conversation. And second, I'd say the conversation also needs, while all this is developing and it's connected to this, it goes back to what I was saying before. What you see here in nonprofit publisher, now we are all here wearing our publisher's hat, but in reality, that's just a sliver of what we do. In reality, what we really do is build communities, as Ron was saying. And the profits that are coming from the publishing, you know, they're not used to buying new cars or new villas on the Rivieras, but are actually used, you know, to fund the activities that the societies do, meetings, travel fellowship, young students, and all that. So, but it's not about, ultimately, it is about money, but it's also about promoting and advancing microbial sciences for us. It's about achieving our goals. And so we also need to be careful that the preprints are tapped to enhance our missions so that we do better what we are supposed to be doing. Because if this is not done thoughtfully and it actually torpedoes the viability of the societies, then one day ASAP Bio will find itself to be organizing 300, you know, annual meetings for 300 different groups, for putting out travel fellowships, for publishing everything, and so on and so forth. So you see what I'm saying. So, I mean, the innovation is fantastic, and I see this as a great innovation process, great experiment. But I think that's part of the reason why we need to be in the conversation, because it's also a very fragile and delicate ecosystem, which I know you don't want to hurt, but needs to be part of the conversation.
Well, you know, I think we'd love to brainstorm with you on this. I want to emphasize that ASAP Bio is going to make a transition to being kind of a secretariat or an organizing body for this governance body that's going to be created, but it could serve as a transmission mechanism, if you'd like, between you know, the community and that governance body, you know, to kind of have information kind of flow well between those two. You know, in reality, I think we're breaking new ground here. I think there are a lot of governance bodies that work behind, you know, kind of closed doors, and, you know, decisions come out. And, you know, I think the spirit of openness of preprint should embrace a spirit of openness of governance. And, you know, I kind of view our biggest role in ASAP Bio going forward is not governing, because we want to actually have separate bylaws for a separate, you know, unit that entity that does that. But we'd love to innovate in that transmission mechanism, for which, you know, in reality, there are not that many perfect models out there. So, you know, again, just thinking about the way we can pull like scientists, which you're good at polling because you have access to members in ways that we don't have. But, you know, for us to get good information in front of that governance body so they can make good decisions would be, I think, a very important mission going forward. And not that we need to think through all this immediately, But I think it is something very worthwhile to think through in the next year. That transcends, that will transcend the bylaws, which are going to be very much like your bylaws, very voting right, you know, what governance body is supposed to do and should not do. But I think how we gather information from the community is something that we can also learn to iterate over time. And again, that's something not only we'd like the advice from scientific societies at the leadership level, but also at your scientist level. That is incredibly valuable to us. So again, maybe this is not a final statement, but offering this as a dialogue that we'd love to figure this out, you know, over the course of the next year.
So Joe McInerney, the American Society of Human Genetics. As you try to collect those data that you're interested in, I want to emphasize that just as you indicated that biology is not a monolith, neither is any of the societies, in a sense. I mean, each of us has to deal with an editorial staff. We have to deal with a commercial publisher, quite likely. We have to deal with an annual meeting that may well be influenced by information on preprint servers in terms of the content we accept for our meeting. We have senior investigators as members. We have trainees as members. So don't look at us as just, in this case, the American Society of Human Genetics, and this is what you can expect from any individual society. We just as you're trying to meet all kinds of objectives, we have to address the needs of those various components of our societies as well, as we try to, if you wish us to, try to sell our members on this prospect.
Well, I kind of view that as a strength rather than a weakness, in the sense that, you know, a society is kind of a microcosm of, you know, the different stakeholders of a system within a scientific discipline. So in a sense, you kind of already, as you say, are operating in a picture where you're integrating information on what's best for trainees, what's best for science overall, how do we execute business models within our societies. I think the fact that societies are thinking through all those issues, as I said, it makes your lives complicated, I am sure. But in a way, that's like an asset to us, because we're trying to think through multiple stakeholders. And, so I appreciate actually when you leave this room, even when you discuss preprints with all of your journal editorial boards, this is not an easy job for you as executive directors of running a society with many components. We totally appreciate that point, because we're living in that world too, as ASAP Bio. But in that sense, we kind of have common challenges together, and even thinking through those multi, you know, stakeholder challenges, what your experiences are, is valuable information to us as well.
So Brooks Hansen, AGU, just a couple perspectives, kind of getting at your question of what you might look for in from societies. First, just a plea that I'm sure you're doing this, but getting back to my point, that the reason archive.org has worked is it's an aggregator across content and is essentially the aggregator in physics. What's happening now is that a variety of preprint servers are being stood up. And so interoperability among these is going to be critical in a whole variety of forms. So I think it's not just ASAP Bio and its governance board, but interacting with the governance boards of these others to set some interoperability standards and functionality will be really critical for the vision that Phil and others have presented to be realized. The second point is that, it's been mentioned in a lot of other societies, how content is being
produced is really dramatically changing right now. There's a whole variety of online authoring tools, and these authoring tools don't extend just to papers, they extend to posters and presentations and aspects like that. And in many ways, so AGU runs one of the largest scientific society meetings in the world, 25,000 members, 22,000 abstracts, about which 18,000 are posters. So every year. So, and the posters are just as rich as every as a scientific paper in many cases. And there's online tools for actually creating those papers that actually make them look like papers. So I would just think, encourage you and the other people considering preprint service to think very broadly about what a preprint might be going forward. So those are just, and that, you know, I think for all of us who have societies, that's actually the meetings are a big one-time huge outpouring of science, and then most of that science, if you weren't at the meeting, is actually lost until it's published or redistributed. And so one of the biggest gains might be ways of capturing that rich meeting content going forward.
Thank you. That's a fantastic point. And I completely agree with you that the format of a preprint needs to be flexible and under ongoing discussion. One other element that we've been having conversations about specifically with the Chan Zuckerberg initiative is the element of code and how do we bring code and software into preprints. And how
so,
do we,
so just an advice on that, code definitely should not have a CC BY license. So just to be very clear on that, an MIT license or some other CC BY actually gets in the way of reusing software.
Mm. So could you elaborate on that a bit?
Because it's attribution.
So that is too restrictive. In other words, it's too restrictive.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, we can't hear you anymore.
We're just looking at each other awkwardly.
You're back. It's okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Maria.
I think we couldn't. I don't know if this would be a useful exercise, and I guess maybe I'm just wondering if we go around the room and if there are any like closing thoughts that people just want to say individually that might be, you know, as a like complete summary, and you can pass if you'd like, or you can take the opportunity. But it might be good just to let everyone have a chance to speak and on a very open mic basis on any topic you feel like is just worth mentioning at the close of this very useful meeting.
So from the PNAS standpoint, I think the concerns that have been expressed about the licensing really merit a lot of further investigation. Even we aren't clear if a preprint is published under a certain license, does that require that any further publication be published under the same license? Our lawyers tell us generally yes, and from our experience, when authors publish a preprint, and then submit to publication in our journal, it's essentially the same paper. That makes it a little bit sticky. One of the questions, too, is I think in the community, as people learn about this initiative and the acceptance of preprints, is are preprints intended to be terminal publication? As they gain acceptance from the funders, will the funders, because now in grant applications, people are saying, well, you can put them on your grant applications, just means that reviewers have to read the actual paper and determine for themselves if the preprint qualifies as an acceptable research outcome. Would that be the same for satisfying funder requirements for open access or public access? Is there an intention for that to become terminal publication and replace the journal system? I know you've said explicitly it isn't, but maybe the community would evolve. And I think in that case, it would be important to bring along societies and publishers in that regard. And then Stefano and ASM have done a lot of work on the developing these front porches, and a lot of associations and societies are developing a lot of resources to developing preprint servers and developing community tools. Is that something that you're looking to do with ASAP Bio, or to foster in the culture of innovation and added products? And then there's a whole commercialization aspect of that. So I think those are just a few issues.
I don't want to take much time, but I think the notion is that this would be a database upon which other innovators can use. And the more innovators that come into the system, which includes scientific societies, the better.
So I'll just build a little bit on what Diane said, is that I think one of our major concerns is that by bringing in full text of preprints from across many different servers, and then building on that and adding new features and requirements and innovations, that those steps are leading towards taking over that ecosystem from journal articles. That then the goal seems to be to enhance publication of preprints to the point where the journal article, maybe it's an article of record, more of the way it is in physics journals, but where the real excitement now has shifted away from scholarly journal publication to enhanced full text preprints.
If I could just respond briefly to that, I hope that any innovations that we create are going to be licensed under these open source licenses to permit any entities, any publishers to also use them. I think the goal is really to, if new tools are developed from the ASAP Bio perspective, for that to elevate anyone else's opportunities.
And also the clarity of peer-reviewed and not peer-reviewed. I mean, I think if you take the temperature of the scientific community right now, peer review is extremely important. And there's no indication that is going away. The central service, the boundary line of what that central service does or does not do is very much draws a line in the sand around peer review, that is not a function. It's a neutral database. It's not slipping into the waters of peer review. So I think the notion that this is going to replace journals, I just don't think it's a reality, and I don't think that's going to happen. I think the opportunity for journals to use this in interesting ways that actually helps them, as Jessica says, is I think the spirit of this mission. And I just hope that through further conversations that will be also clearer and be embraced. But that's, I think that's the goal, and I think that's what will be the reality and the outcome as well.
Again, after 25 or now 25 years of the archive, journals have not gone away in any of the fields that are posting preprints. They remain important, and physicists still care if they get their paper into PhysRev letters, and mathematicians want to get it into the annals. And so journal prestige as well as peer review still coexist as values in those communities. And I see no reason why it wouldn't be different in our own.
So to the point of just augmenting peer-reviewed publications, using these for another purpose in applications and progress reports, I still think we need a little bit more dialogue on guidance for our reviewers and how peer review, how these interim research projects can be used in review of applications and progress reports.
In thinking about a smoother transition from a preprint to a published article, Brooks mentioned standards and technical standards and interoperability, and I was thinking all along of ethical and reproducibility and rigor standards. And you had mentioned within the government's governance remit that there would be some filtering involved. And many of the standards have been set by funders, by NIH, by NSF. Many of them are also down to the community. So I would urge that there would be consideration of those kinds of standards that many of us in publishing in societies have worked in the past few years, especially very hard to achieve new enhancements to our method requirements for integrity in research. I really support everything that was just said. And I think the first comment that was made was very, very important, and that's the issue of the interpretation by the general press and also the implications for data mining for unpublished materials. So the press, as we know, and if any of us have ever looked at John Oliver, know that not everything is as interpreted as it ought to be for what's real. And I think it's a responsibility for all of us to make sure that the difference between what's been vetted and what has not been vetted is communicated to the broader communities, because we could do a better job already in that area. And so we need to think about that. Thank you.
I would just say I'd love to have a longer discussion of that, because I think it might be useful for us as a whole community to, I don't know, maybe this is in the form of an article, even in a, you know, a visible place where the discussion of the issues, even of non-peer review as well as peer review, really are clarified. Because I think, in reality, I think both discussions, both kinds of educational processes has to occur. And, you know, how to do that well and how to articulate it well, and whether there's a place that could be a common, you know, article or something that would be a guidepost for this, it's worth consideration. At least I'm not aware of maybe there is, and someone could correct me, but if there was a, you know, a educated member of the public or press where you could point to as something that is a really good educational piece on these points.
Most societies will have ethical guidelines of some sort. Those may be specific to journals and communities. And probably most of the folks around the table belong to an organization called COPE, Committee on Publication Ethics. And so those are two ways that communities address, in our case, we address the ethical guidelines to the publication of chemical research, not just in our journals, but in general. So.
Just speaking on what you were just talking about, if you wanted to look into how else to address the public in that, I would reach out to science educators, get to the education side of stuff, and pull them in specifically for this, because they know how to communicate to the public better than scientists.
I don't have a specific comment. I just appreciate having the discussion and having several of FASB's member societies here as well in person to participate, and we look forward to future dialogue.
David Nelson, American Journal of Human Genetics. I would strongly echo what many things that Stefano said, but most importantly, the consideration of preprints as interim research products. I think it is confusing in our community, in the genetics and genomics community, as to whether a preprint is the final product or not. And you know, I think as much as we think peer review is important, there's certainly a lot in our community who are happy to, you know, stop at the preprint stage, and you know, that is a threat to the established journals. So I think that's something that needs to be emphasized over and over again. Also in our community, I think there's concerns with preprints that involve human subjects and medical issues and, you know, items that the public is interested in that, you know, verge on medical advice. And those as preprints, unreviewed, unverified, can have the potential for harm. And so I think there's great concern in our community where there's more medically oriented publications that those be vetted carefully if they're going to appear as preprints. And that raises my third point, which is I, as well as members of our society and community, are very interested in how these are going to be vetted. I think Neil spoke to some issues that the NIH would like to see in terms of vetting of preprints. But each one of those raises costs, and those costs continue to accelerate and have potential of torpedoing the entire enterprise if there's if you're basically reinventing the journal system to vet the preprint before it goes online. So as I understand, BioArchive does very, very light vetting at this point, just to make sure that it looks like a scientific paper and it doesn't contain profanity. But if you're going to be checking for, human subjects protocols and whether or not patients are identified and, all sorts of things that we do as a journal, that's going to take staff and time.
Nick Shockey from Spark. I was really excited to hear Darla's comments about how the next generation of researchers was really driving preprints at ACS and their excitement, and I would be really interested to talk about how we can support and leverage the interest of the next generation of researchers to help drive the adoption of preprints and culture change more broadly, because I think there is obviously a lot of energy there, and I think they can be a really, really effective force in driving this.
My just one comment, I'm Elizabeth Austin with the American Association of Anatomists, is I always think about my members and they love to put things on their CV, and what the field is thinking about preprints as far as, promotion and tenure and things like that, especially in these newer fields, life sciences, where they're not as common as in physics.
I'm Barbara Jasny from Science, and we do serve multiple communities, and the cultural differences are very real, but in terms of recognition, priority, what is the final product, and other aspects that have been talked about, and that will have to be discussed more. It will be very good to have a more quantitative sense of what percent of papers actually have comments, what proportion of our audience really will be benefited by this, and what percentage of those comments are useful. Hopefully there will be ongoing tracking of this, as well as of downloads, use, citation, all that information can help.
Not a major comment, but just wanted to say that as a representative of the only commercial publisher here, if there is an opportunity to stay engaged, and as these issues continue to be discussed, Wiley would very much like to participate. So thank you.
Let's say thank you for the meeting.
Well, there's some folks on the...
Thank you all for a very stimulating discussion and for bringing to us the concerns from your societies. We really, really appreciate it and look forward to your engagement moving forward.
Just to echo Cynthia, thank you so much, and I hope that we can continue to have more conversations like this in the future. Thank you.
Yeah. Very useful to hear the concerns. I also want to say very good to hear the enthusiasm as well, because I think really want to emphasize all the
the benefits that could happen, you know, by a productive intersection here. I mean, I think Stefano really highlighted what, you know, a lot of reasons why there are scientific societies, which is, you know, to advance science, advance the careers of young individuals, and promote innovation and interesting dialogue. So, yeah, this is, I would just say this is like our first meeting. It was great to have an opportunity to meet everyone. I fully suspect this is not going to be the last such meeting that we're going to have with scientific societies. Also, we appreciate your time from your day to come here. I think if we leave you with any message, it is that, you know, Forward Progress is going to be a consensus-building effort, and it is going to be a dialogue. It's a dialogue that we can have with you. It's a dialogue that you can have with your scientific members. And also, just even offline, if any of you want to just call us on the phone, have a longer discussion, that would be incredibly welcome. It doesn't always have to be in this formal kind of setting. So just opening that up. I will say the other reason why we wanted to have this is that we are recognizing that there are a number of things that are going to be happening that are worth paying attention to that we would like to engage your input with. I mean, this includes everything from, as I said, we're going to have a task force on licensing, just to think through these issues with interesting, diverse people as part of that. We're going to have further, you know, consideration of the governance. That's going to be happening in the next few months. And again, the goal is to be very thoughtful as we go along. And in that sense, we embrace all of you as partners. So anyway, thank you very much. And thank you for your generous time in coming here. Thank you to the speakers as well. And all I could say is we learned a lot from today. We're going to certainly go back and think about many of the feedback that we got. And I hope this was an interesting day for you as well. So anyway, thank you very much. Thank you.